Glad you joined us today as we're going to begin a study in the book of Philippians. Now, going from Ecclesiastes to Philippians is quite a flip. It's kind of a breath of fresh air. Now, in the end, Solomon realized that the only way to enjoy the good things of life was with a proper relationship to God. But there was a lot of pessimism in there. This letter, this book, is exactly the opposite. Many have called it the epistle of joy, because all throughout the book, Paul talks about his joy and that he has with the Philippian church, which is amazing considering that when Paul wrote this, he was in prison and that he had no idea when he was going to get out. He could have faced execution. He didn't. He got out and eventually went back and was executed, but he didn't face execution at this one. But he didn't know that at that point. He was probably chained to a Roman soldier, but still he had joy. He understood that for the believer, our happiness, our joy is not based on what's happening around us. It's not based on our circumstance. It's based in the knowledge that we're in God's hands and God is controlling everything and leading us through his path if we will follow him. Coincidentally, Paul had actually been in prison in Philippi where he's writing this letter to the Philippians there at the church. Philippians is one of four letters that are called the prison epistles that he wrote while he was in prison there in Rome. Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians, and Philemon were all written, we believe, while Paul was in prison in Rome. One unique thing about Philippians is it's the only epistle where he doesn't focus on major problems within the church. I would dare to say that Philippi was his favorite church. They had supported him. They had loved him. They had been faithful to him for years. And so instead of focusing on problems, he focuses on joy, on unity, our relationship with Christ. He mentions Jesus 42 times. He mentions joy 13 times. Our relationship with Christ goes hand to hand with joy for the believer. If we're rightly related to Christ, that joy is going to be a byproduct of that. So let's jump into Philippians, and we're going to start right at the beginning of the book in chapter 1. Philippians chapter 1, verse 1. Paul and Timothy, bondservants of Jesus Christ, to all the saints in Christ Jesus who are in Philippi, with the bishops and deacons, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Now it was customary in ancient times to put the name of the author of the letter first. Sometimes, if there was a co-author, they would put both names first. Now, we don't believe Timothy had much to do with the writing of this book. We believe he was with Paul when Paul wrote this book. And we believe the reason that Paul added Timothy here right at the beginning is because Timothy was so familiar to the people at Philippi. He had been there the first time Paul went. He had gone back on a subsequent journey to check on the church. When Paul was there the first time, he wound up in jail. And it's very likely that Timothy had to take some sort of leadership role in that. When Paul was in jail. So he was very familiar to them. He was a close friend of not only Paul, but also the Philippians. And so Paul mentions, hey, I'm here with Timothy. He calls them bond servants. In the first century, that word would have been slave. In the first century of the ancient world, it's estimated that maybe two-thirds of all people in the Roman Empire were actually slaves. It was a huge society. But what that bondservant or slave meant is that someone was owned by someone else. They were totally dependent on that person for their sustenance, and they served that person without any thought of their own needs or interests. This is what one New Testament commentator said about it. when we use this word in the New Testament of a believer's relationship to Jesus, doulos, or slave, describes willing, determined, and devoted service. It reflects the attitude of the Old Testament slave who refused the opportunity for freedom and voluntarily submitted to his master for life. If you remember that in Exodus, it said, if you try to let your slave go and he says, no, I want to stay, that you take him to the door of the house and you pierce his ear with an awl. And that means that he has dedicated himself to you for life. Now, that's hard for us to understand, but that was part of the culture in those days. And that was the attitude of Paul, that he and Timothy were bondservants, were slaves to Christ for their life. They were giving all to him. Paul calls the believers at Philippi saints. Now, we're saints because of our relationship with Christ, not because of what we've done. Paul also calls those troubled believers at Corinth saints. In 1 Corinthians 1:2, to the church of God was at Corinth, to those who are sanctified in Christ Jesus, called to be saints. Two chapters later, he says, And I, brethren, could not speak to you as spiritual people, but as carnal, so as to be babes in Christ. I fed you with milk and not with solid food, for until now you were not able to receive it. And even now you're not able, for you are still carnal. So even though Paul calls them saints, that didn't mean they were super spiritual. That just means they were believers in Christ. And that's what Paul calls them. He says all the saints. Paul uses that word all many times throughout this book. And many people believe that's because he's really stressing unity and coming together and everyone together. He adds, which he normally doesn't, overseers and bishops. And the thought there is that he did that to, again, stress unity. All the saints and the overseers and bishops, thinking that that means that everyone is a saint, everyone's on the same level playing field. Some have different functions, you know, like in our church. We have pastors, we have deacons, we have Sunday school teachers, we have different ministry leaders, but all of them are saints. All of them are believers in God's eyes. Verse 2 gives that familiar Pauline greeting, grace and peace. We've all received grace from God. And because of that, we can have peace knowing that he's in control. Again, another commentator says this, the sum total of God's activity toward human creatures is found in the word grace. Nothing's deserved, nothing can be achieved. But the sum total of those benefits is peace. Because of the way God has treated us, we can have peace even in the middle of this crazy time that our world, that our nation is going through, even our community is going through right now. Peace flows out of grace. Because we have grace, we can experience peace regardless of what's going on around us. Verse 3, I thank my God upon every remembrance of you, always in every prayer of mine, making requests for you with all joy, for your fellowship in the gospel from the first day until now, being confident of this very thing, that he who began a good work in you will complete it until the day of Christ Jesus. That word that Paul uses when he says, I thank you at every remembrance, is the word Eucharist. It's where we get the word Eucharist that some faiths use as what they call the Lord's Supper. We do the supper because we're thankful. We do the supper to remember because of what God did for us. Paul says that he prays to my God, showing a personal, intimate relationship with God, remembering the faithfulness, the generosity of the Philippians brought joy to his heart, even though he was in chains, even though he was in prison. And because of that, he prayed for them. John MacArthur said this, an infallible test of godly joy is the degree to which a believer prays more earnestly for the benefit and blessing of others than his own. When we are living in Christ, when Christ is controlling us, we care about others and not just the things that affect us. In verse 5, Paul says he's thankful for their fellowship and partnership in the gospel. That word fellowship is koinonia. It's a very familiar word to us, but it also means partnership. And so it's more than just, hey, we're friends, we do things together, we eat together occasionally. It's they were working together. They were partnering together. Sure, we find out later in the book that they had been financially generous with Paul, but also just the idea of them working to spread the gospel with Paul. And the gospel refers to really the whole story of the New Testament, especially in the area of evangelism. And so they were helping Paul with ministry. They were helping Paul in spreading the gospel throughout the region. But it says that, verse 6 says that he's confident, or he's been persuaded, that what has started will be completed. Did he have that kind of faith in the Philippians? No. He had that kind of faith in God. He said, he who began a good work in you will complete it until the day of Christ Jesus. Paul knew that was going to be completed because it was God who was doing it. It was not the Philippians. I found this quote by F.B. Meyer, a commentator of the last century. We go into the artist's studio and find their unfinished pictures, coverings with large canvases, and suggesting great designs, but which have been left either because the genius was not competent to complete the work or because paralysis laid the hand low in death. But as we go into God's great workshop, we find nothing that bears the mark of haste or insufficiency of power to finish. And we are sure that the work which his grace has begun, the arm of his strength will complete. In other words, God calls us to himself, and he begins a good work in us. And as long as we follow him, he's going to continue that work until the day of Christ Jesus. You know, many times in the Old Testament, it talks about the day of the Lord, and in the Old Testament as well. And often that brings ideas of judgment and the end of the world, those sorts of things. Well, that's not what Paul's talking about. He's talking about the joy that we as believers will experience when Christ comes back. We'll have a new body. We'll see Jesus, and it'll be a glorious time. Look at verse 7. Just as it is right for me to think this of you, because I have you in my heart, inasmuch as both in chains and in the defense and confirmation of the gospel, you all are partakers with me of grace. For God is my witness how I long for you all with the affection of Jesus Christ. Paul says that it's right for him to think or feel this way about them because he has them in his heart. They've been partners with him for over a decade at this point. They've been faithful. They've been generous. He has a real affection for them. It says that they have helped him in defense of the gospel. That word, that comes from that word that we get apologetics, that they have helped him defend or help the gospel where they're at. And then confirmation is just sort of the positive complement to that, that they have affirmed the truth of the gospel. Now think about it. Paul was in jail. And to stand with Paul, to defend the gospel with Paul, could have had very negative consequences for the Philippians. They could have wound up in jail as well. But because they love Paul, because they love God, they stood with him and defended him. That word affection there is the word that they use for the internal organs. So this is a deep feeling with Paul. This is real love, compassion that touched Paul in a very deep way. It was the love of God working through the apostle to the Philippians and then back to the apostles. Verse 9, and this I pray, that your love may abound still more and more in knowledge and all discernment, that you may approve the things that are excellent, that you may be sincere and without offense till the day of Christ, being filled with the fruits of righteousness, which are by Jesus Christ, to the glory and praise of God. Paul prays that their love will abound between each other and to the world. Every believer ought to have that kind of love. Jesus said that when he was here on earth. Matthew 22:37, when they ask him what the greatest commandment is, he shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. And the second is like it, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Jesus told his disciples the night before he was crucified, by this all will know that you are my disciples if you have love for one another. This kind of love is that godly love, agape love, that the Bible talks about. It's a love that's unending. It's a love that has no limits, but it does have boundaries. I love the way Chuck Swindoll put it. He said he prayed that their love would continue to grow and be characterized by real knowledge and discernment. I like to picture love like a river. It needs to be guided by the banks of knowledge and discernment. Paul isn't telling the Philippians to let love blind them to truth and righteousness so they overlook sin. That's a false interpretation of love we often see in the world today. True Christian love is guided by the best interest of others. With true knowledge and discernment, learn love to spot the phony, the wrong, the evil. It learns to approve the things that are excellence. You know, sometimes when we love people, when we care about people, we've got to point out things to them that are not going right, some things that they need to avoid, some things maybe that they need to fix. That's what true love is about. Paul said he wanted them to be sincere. That word comes from sincere, which means without wax. In the ancient world, they made pottery out of clay, and many times when they fired it, it would develop cracks, and it was no good. Well, unscrupulous merchants would fill that crack with wax and paint over it and sell it like it was fine. But you could hold it up to the sun, and you could see those cracks. And so honest merchants would label their products sincere or without wax to show the quality of what they did. Jesus was pretty tough on hypocrites. Matthew 7, he says, "Hypocrite, first remove the plank from your own eye, and then you'll see clearly to remove the speck from your brother's eye." Verse 11 shows the goal for all true Christians is to love him, to obey him, not for our own benefit, but for the glory of God. Paul said in Corinthians, "Whether you eat or drink, whatever you do, do it all for the glory of God." In Ephesians, he says, "Now to him who is able to do more abundantly beyond all we ask, think, or imagine, according to power that works in us, to him be the glory forever and ever." The main goal of our life, the main goal of us as human beings, is to glorify God and to bring praise to him. Great study in Philippians. I'm looking so forward to it. I hope you will continue to do that. I hope you'll continue to live your life, not for yourself, but for the glory of God. Thanks for joining us. Hope to see you again next week.